Today is Thursday, January 25th. We're so glad that you are joining us on this Quest 52 journey as we are diving into the life of Jesus, learning from him because we want to be more like Jesus. Our hope in life is to connect to Jesus, to connect to each other, and to connect to his mission. And we hope that your journey through the life of Jesus this year just gets you closer to Jesus, each other, and his mission as we are going forward. We're excited for today. As always, we've been diving into the discussion questions together. So we're just going to go through them together. And again, we would love for you to dialogue, to have a conversation with us, even digitally, leaving comments in the comment section or texting one of us or emailing us or even talking to someone in your life just about what God is teaching you. Mm-hmm. Here's what it says. First question, who are the heroes in your life that led you to a place where you could believe? These kind of heroes, examples could be family members, mentors, or peers. Who are the heroes in your life?
Well, and just so y'all know, like, we've not rehearsed this ahead of time. In fact, I tried to look at the questions a minute ago, but Keenan said it was time to start.
It's time to go.
So
it's
here we are. Heroes in my life that led me to where I could believe, right? Mm-hmm. Man, I would love, and I think all of us, maybe, I would choose to believe. We would like to say, you know, our mom and our dad, our parents, things. And my parents were certainly influential in my life. I can't discount that at all. Certainly influential. But if I were to look outside of my family, like an outside influence on my life that way, there were a few people, you know, that I can look back, I can name them. Scott Springer and David Stevens and second name, and there's others. I'm blanking on at the moment. But that invested in me through this church right here.
Yeah.
And I remember even, I got baptized when I was 10 years old, about 10 or so-ish. Think. I got baptized and but that didn't mean like I had it all figured out then. Like I was still a kid and growing up, and actually I remember being about 17 or so years old. I had just had a dumb moment driving a car and had a bad car wreck, and I remember sitting in a hospital, like in the hallway, and David Stevens was our youth minister at the time, and he came and we had a conversation, and I look back to that moment as kind of a stepping off point for me. Like it's gotta be serious if I'm gonna follow Jesus here.
Yeah. I think for me, of course, I would say my parents too. I mean, that's why I'm in ministry, actually. My dad's pastor, and my mom is a pastor's wife. So I grew up in wanting and longing for that, to follow my parents' footsteps. Beyond them, though, I think at different moments in my life, I needed something different, and I needed a different type of person. I can think of Sunday school teachers. I think of third grade, Mrs. Eichelberger in third grade. And I think of different people in my life growing up that were intentional with me, this hyperactive ADHD kid, but wanted me to love Jesus and had immense patience with me and just pouring into my life. I think of youth ministers, Keith Wilkins, and actually his wife, Sonia, is the reason why I'm a worship pastor today. In eighth grade, she was pouring into seventh and eighth graders and helping them learn to lead worship. And she asked me if I would want to learn to do this. I was just a vocalist. Mm-hmm. And she said, hey, if you learn to play guitar, I would love for you to lead because I'm pregnant and I'm going to have a baby here in 6 or 7 months. And so she helped prep me, and it worked those three songs forever and ever and ever.
Yes.
But then I was ready because she poured into me. And so 18 years later, I'm doing this now because of that moment as an eighth grader that she saw that God could use me for bigger things. And then I think of Bo Hamlin. He was my youth minister in high school. He's back in the area working for God's Resort, and he was influential on me. And like, we are intentional shepherds first before musicians. I mean, just all these different people at different moments and different voices I needed.
Yeah, I think you're right. Actually, as you're talking, I'm thinking in my life, there's more than that even. Like, because different seasons, right?
Yeah.
That is such a key thing. And it's not always, and Keen, I hear you, it's not always church people. Even.
Nope.
Like it's not always the ministers and the youth ministers. And I remember when I was in junior high school, a teacher, Keith Kirk, in my life, Patty DeArmond, in my life. And I remember they used an event called History Day. I was a nerd. Maybe you know about me already. But growing up in history, competing in these history events and things, and they used that just to kind of invest in me and to say, hey, like you have potential to do some things, and that was huge for me. And I think of Brenda Hawkins and Steve Sigler and saying, hey, as a 16-year-old kid, they're like, hey, we think you should go and travel across the world with us. And so when I was 17, I spent a month out of the country with them and continued to travel and mission trips and experiences. And So not always church people even, like people outside that, through school and through other organizations, really invested in me a lot.
I know this is not necessarily the question, but just thinking through it a little bit, I think it's so vital. If you're a teacher watching this, or a Sunday school teacher, the importance of most of the people in my life that had the biggest influence on me, outside of my parents, because my parents were the biggest influences in my life, were really not pastors, although they had parts of it, but it's the adults the pastors poured into who were pouring into me.
Yeah.
And so if you're serving in our kids ministry or you're at an Oikos pouring into kids, or you're a teacher in the schools, like your impact, you have no idea 20 years from now, the life a kid could be living for the kingdom of God because you chose to be faithful where you are.
Yeah.
Side note, if you're not serving in our kids or student ministries, we are growing like crazy and we need more hands. That wasn't planned, just so you know. That wasn't planned. But
we take every opportunity, you know, for whatever.
because it is true. Like, they had the biggest influence on my life because they knew me. They knew my parents. And so my parents had this ongoing conversations with, these are things we're doing at home. These are things we're struggling with that they could pour into in different ways. And so just the symbiotic relationship between the church family and my parents and me helped me become who I am today.
Yeah, and I mean, teachers are huge, right? In the church, teachers, my life, Harlan Mitchell and Newt White, and people that taught me growing up, I honestly can't tell you a thing they taught me. Like, I can't recite a lesson to you, but they taught me how to be somebody who follows Jesus.
Yes.
And that example was massive.
I agree with that. I don't think I can think of any lesson I've ever learned in church, but I learned from their examples of just loving people. So if you end up watching this and you're one of those people, thank you. Thank you for your commitment and pouring into our lives. Here's the next question, because I want to also honor our time together. Mm-hmm. If you were Mary, what would be your greatest concerns about accepting God's call? And then, because of that, what are your greatest concerns about your own call?
Well, I know this is not what you meant, but if I were Mary, I'd be concerned about being pregnant, actually, because I'm a dude. But
that is a good point.
I mean, see,
that aside, sir.
Maybe I shouldn't have said that on you. I don't know.
We're not cutting it, though.
I'm telling you, this is live. We don't rehearse this. We are real people. And I like to think we're funny people. So there's that.
I did tell people on Sunday this was worth watching. So
that's right.
You never know where it's going.
What was the question,
Keenan? So let's do it one more time. A question, right. Okay? If you were Mary, what would be your greatest concerns about accepting God's call? And what are your greatest concerns about your own calling because of it?
Yeah. No, really, though, I joked, and I was being silly and carried away a bit. The being pregnant and the having the child and the future, because she was so young. Like, if I were in her situation being that young and, you know, God through an angel saying, okay, this is going to set the course of the rest of your life and all future people are going to be dependent upon your caring for this child like a mother. And that's huge. I mentioned a minute ago, sitting in a hospital hallway and kind of a moment that I can look back to, and I can point back and I can tell you our conversation in that moment. And I can tell you what we read in the Bible in that moment. I can tell you all those things. And I was 17 years old and I was scared. And I didn't fully grab hold of all that then even. But to be even younger than that and to be tasked with raising the Messiah, that's crazy.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I agree with that, and I'm just sitting there thinking a little bit. The first word that popped into my head, though, also was loss. Mary would have gone to school a little bit. Like, she would have gone to the local synagogue and would have learned about the Old Testament laws and practices. She would have been familiar in her culture about what happens to a young lady and being ostracized from their culture for being pregnant outside of marriage, for the relationship. I mean, she was in a town of her cousins and distant family members, that she would have shamed them for being pregnant by accepting the call of God. And yet, as we talked about on Sunday, she said, as you've said, let it be. You know, despite the loss that was to come, she would rather say yes and be obedient to God.
Yeah.
And I think the answer to the second question is similar for me. Is I think what holds me back, the greatest concerns, is I get caught up in what might I lose. Because what got me to this point, relationships and different things, to get me to the next point, I might lose some of those things because they may not like the direction God's calling me into, right? Mm-hmm. And that's hard to choose to be obedient to God because what's around me becomes my comfort. Yeah. And I start to lean into those things instead of God, which is not what you're supposed to do. I get that. But we do. We lean into that rest of the things around us. I'm not saying that you'll lose everything by being obedient to God, but you could. Mm-hmm. You could in the next season. So I think in my own calling, what God's calling me into, maybe it's a friendship, maybe a person, maybe if you're watching this, maybe you're like, I feel God calling me to be more vocal about my faith. Just not necessarily in a mean way, but just letting people know I follow Jesus. Mm-hmm. And they may stop talking to you. Those conversations with coworkers may stop happening because they're like, I don't like Jesus people. You don't know, but that's a hard choice to make, right? And to walk into.
There's a lot of risk involved there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Fear the unknown.
Mm-hmm. We've talked about, FOMO, fear of missing out a lot mm-hmm. over our history and recent culture and a lot. I heard somebody talk the other day about a new one. It's the fear of losing out, right? Mm. Losing out on something. It's not even missing out on something fun later. It's just losing something that I already have. And it's very real.
Yeah.
It keeps us
locked
in.
Because it becomes a foundation. Mm-hmm. The things that we've clamored for and worked for. And again, those things necessarily weren't bad, but they become our foundation instead of Jesus. I know they do in my own life. And if I'm afraid to lose those things, then I can be afraid of taking the necessary risks and steps that God's asked me to do in obedience.
You're right.
Third thing is, what is God calling you to do with your life to bring Him glory?
You know, this changes, I think, over time. Mm-hmm. We know, all believers are called to be a disciple who makes more disciples. Jesus told us all, go make disciples of all the nations. He told us clearly, that's the great commission to do this thing, right? But I think within that, we all view it through our own perspective, our own thing. And this, I think it does shift a little and change a little bit over time. And there was a time in my life that, I felt that my calling to bring God glory was all about just, being a youth minister loving kids and teens. And I still love teens and kids. And then for a while I was preaching, and I wanted to be this preacher. And I'll be honest with you, there's a part of me, that shadow side of me, that has a little pride and a little ego that wants the bigger stage and the whole thing, right? And I've had to push that away, push them, release that. Right now, over the last couple of years, really, and you hear this in my words when I speak, but it's really been more about investing. Like, I believe God has called me to make an eternal investment into people. And that's not always on a stage. It's not always in front of the lights. Sometimes it's on a Zoom call. And I have people I meet with weekly on Zoom calls that aren't around here even, because I want to invest in people. And sometimes that's in a living room, or it's just sitting in a ball game. But I believe God's called me to invest in people, to help pass along what's in me, so that the next person can be greater than I am, and that God can use them in even greater ways.
Yeah, I think I totally agree with you in the sense that I think every season of my life has been different, mm-hmm. right? I think back in early college, my dream was to travel in a Christian rock band and lead worship, which if you're around us on Sundays, that's why I really like the poppy, upbeat tempo songs. That's how I like to worship Jesus with joy. And I'm not saying that we should, there's other ways to worship Jesus through also mm-hmm. just on reflection. But that was a season of my life. I traveled, I recorded in Nashville. I did some other things. And then I felt God closing that chapter of my life. And I hated it because I felt like that was my calling. And it was for that season. Mm-hmm. And then I was poured into ministry. And I remember saying these words, because church ministry is not easy. Leading in a church is not easy. And I watched my dad and mom go through some hard times in their life, and I remember thinking, I never want to be a pastor at a local church. And it's really funny to see how God's brought about that, because I went into parachurch ministry working with college students that led me to here, and now I'm over a decade here on staff at a church doing the thing I said I would never do. And it's changing for me. I even think about this new season in my life, the North Heights campus, and helping launch that. Like, I didn't want to move into North Heights. I was terrified of moving into North Heights because I read the statistics about the break-ins and the drug usage and different things. And I was like, that place doesn't have Jesus. And it was my wife who said, well, that's why we go. And I hated, I was really angry that she was the one with that answer, because I'm the pastor and I felt like I needed to be one with the Jesus answer. But I was running from my calling in that moment. But this is my season of life, pouring into this church. I feel like I'm here and this season for a reason for what we're doing. But I would not have been here if I didn't do the other things first.
Yeah. Following Jesus, really, it's seasons. Mm-hmm. We go into seasons and we move through these things. And it's really all about letting things go and picking things up.
Yeah.
Because every next step, every next season, we have to let go of one thing to pick a new thing up. And Jesus continues to grow us in our calling and in the way we do these things, which means constantly kind of releasing and grabbing and moving forward.
And again, I hate that because I pick up the thing and I finally feel like I get used to the thing being there.
Yeah, you're right. And one thing we say all the time to each other, and I don't want to pull the curtain back too far for us, but we talk about leading, and we read in a book somewhere once that leading people is disappointing people at a rate they can absorb. And that's really true. Like, trying to lead people to a new thing, to a new place, is there's disappointment involved in letting go of things and picking new things up. And man, do you know what? God leads us the same way.
Yep.
It's constantly a season of learning to be okay with this disappointment so I can get a greater joy later.
Yeah. And sometimes the person you're leading is not the people around you, it's you.
That's exactly it.
Like, you are leading yourself through the disappointment, and that's not always fun.
Yeah.
What is God calling you to do with your life to bring Him glory?
I think we just answered that one.
I think we did. Well, no.
Yeah,
oh, I did. Problem. I'm sorry. This is why this is live, right? I got excited. Last one.
Four.
What are the obstacles keeping you from your next step in fulfilling God's plan for you? And I think I've answered that a little bit, but I think consistently for me, the obstacles keeping me is fear.
Yeah.
Fear of letting go and fear of loss. And I've just learned it's so much easier for me to navigate that when I'm walking through those next steps with somebody, whether it's my wife or the staff around here or the elders, like just the team around me that God has placed to say, hey, we're doing this, but you're not doing it alone. We talked a little bit of that on Sunday, that when God sends you to do something, He never sends you alone. Like, there's a reason for that, because doing it by yourself is really hard. Hard things are easier to do with people around you.
Yeah. I think for me, I think it's similar to that, very similar. I would call it the fear of the what if, you know, the fear of the what if. Like, but what if that happens? But what if that happens? What if this happens? What if that goes on? What if that's better? What if that would have been better? And man, the fear of the what if, I can freeze myself in my tracks playing the what if game. And I have to discipline myself to throw that away.
Yeah.
And to say, what if God wants to do this awesome thing, and I say no. And so I take a step into that instead. And the fear of the what if keeps me back.
Well, those are our answers to those questions. We'd love to hear some of yours. I want to say thank you. Some of you last week did that. You jumped on the video and you left comments on your life verses and things like that. It was so sweet to read through those and just see what God's doing in your life. We'd love to continue the conversation. Some of these questions, though, I think are also great for your family to wrestle with together. Especially if, like, older teenage kids or older kids just wrestle through, like, what's God calling us to do as a family? Mm-hmm. Like, what can we step into in this new season together? And so I would encourage you to do that. Share those stories with us. Because, again, we want to partner with you in connecting your family to Jesus, to one another, and to His mission. It's all about taking next steps together. Adam, why don't you pray for us and then send us from this place?
Yeah, let's pray together. Father God, I thank you for today. I just thank you for all of this, everything that you're doing in us and saying to us. I thank you that we can have real conversations, even off the cuff, conversations that are authentic and transparent. And Father, I believe in those moments, as we are encouraging each other, that you are helping sharpen us and to point us for your direction. I pray that people watching this would be encouraged the same way and would be encouraged to turn around to their families, their spouses, their friends, their coworkers, have the same conversations. And I pray as we do that, that you would be building this family, sharpening us for the journey ahead, and allowing us to see the fruit of your kingdom. And that fruit, if I could just define it, is reflected in people. It's in people that are saying yes to you. I pray we can see that fruit born. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Hey, this Sunday, we're going to be continuing on this journey here. Just talking, we'll be in Luke chapter 2 this Sunday, talking about how God sees us, views us, loves us, and all that. And so I hope you'll join us again Sunday morning, 8 o'clock, 9:30 or 11 in person, 9:30 online on the live stream. It's going to be a great time together.
Yes.
And I can't wait to join you. You know we don't dismiss, we send. And so until we see you then, church, you are sent. Go on mission. Have a great day.